Here comes a very painful statistic. Are you ready? In 2022, we lost 10 million acres of old growth rainforest. That's 11 soccer fields of forest per minute. And it's a 10% increase from the year before. Despite many countries promising to crack down on forest destruction, the vast majority of these losses are happening in the tropics, and specifically in Brazil, which accounted for 40% of tree cover loss in 2022. And we should care about these forests a lot. They store the most carbon and host the most biodiversity on the planet. So can we ever rebuild the forests that we've lost? And how do we do it? I'm Sinéad Bovell, and this is Far Out. Deforestation isn't a modern problem. We've been cutting down trees for agriculture for millennia. What's new is the pace of deforestation. We've lost a third of our forests in the last 10,000 years, but half of those losses happened in the last 100 years. Although deforestation today is happening everywhere, experts say that the Amazon rainforest is nearing a crucial tipping point where significant tree loss will convert the whole forest to degraded scrublands. Why does that matter? Well, the Amazon rainforest is considered to be one of the planet's largest carbon sinks. Quick definition. A carbon sink is simply anything that absorbs more carbon than it produces. So if the Amazon forest disappeared and all that carbon was released, it could be the tipping point that triggers a cascade of climate problems around the world, like melting ice sheets in Antarctica or permanently changing the ocean currents that regulate weather patterns. Obviously, it would be great if we could just stop deforestation. That's the best solution to keeping forests intact. But doing that is complicated. And do we in Western nations have the right to dictate how the least developed nations choose to industrialize when we essentially did whatever we wanted to for 200 years? And for many people, an intact forest is simply worth less than a soybean farm or a herd of cattle, at least in the short term. Ultimately, a lot of these decisions come down to politics. In Brazil, where most of today's deforestation is taking place, the 2023 regime change from President Bolsonaro to President Lula led to a 34% drop in deforestation rates. But we're still cutting down forests at an alarming rate. It's not guaranteed that future political leaders will have the willpower or the resources to stop deforestation altogether before most of these ancient forests are gone forever. That's partially why plant-a-tree initiatives are so popular. Yes, we're cutting down trees, but what if we just replant them at the same time? Makes sense, right? Well, unfortunately, these campaigns are often so poorly executed that they fail catastrophically. An infamous example is in Turkey, where in 2019, a tree planting campaign broke the Guinness Book of World Records for the most trees planted in a single hour in a single location. 3 months later, 90% of those saplings were dead. Some researchers argue that the wrong saplings were planted at the wrong time of year, with little done to help foster their growth. Simply put, we just can't plant saplings and walk away. Even worse, some tree planting campaigns can actually damage ecosystems. If the wrong trees are planted, natural ecosystems can be disturbed. And most tree planting campaigns don't solve the bigger problem. How can we protect and replace old growth forests? So what does work? The answer is both technical and social. Let's start with the technical.
There's quite a narrow suite of species which are very popular for large-scale tree planting, and they're good for certain purposes. They're known to be fast-growing, they're reliable, they're good for producing timber and fiber.
This might seem obvious, but if the goal of reforestation is bringing back what we've lost, then experts say we should plant native trees and not just one or two species that are easy to grow. But in order to plant native trees, you need their seeds. And that's a lot harder than you might think. That's where Kate Hardwick comes in. She works for the Millennium Seed Bank Partnership, which partners with countries to establish native seed collections.
Very often, even though people might know that they will just make the decision that they don't really want to plant exotic species, when they actually get on the ground, they discover that they can't buy seeds and they can't buy seedlings of native species. And so they end up having to do it by default. So this is a really important bottleneck.
Some of these trees are incredibly difficult to grow in a nursery, like the Brazil nut tree. The seed will only germinate if a rodent bites into its hard outer shell, leaves it partially intact, and drops it onto moist soil. Tree nurseries have to mimic this process with machetes and then soak the seeds in water in order for the seed to germinate. It takes a whopping 18 months, but it works. So we've got a germinated native seed, planted in the right spot. All done, right? Well, not quite. We also have to take care of those saplings. A study from 2021 shows that only 18% of tree planting initiatives actively monitor their sites after planting, and only 5% even mention sapling survival rates. It's a theme repeated by researchers all over. If we really want reforestation to work, we can't just throw saplings in the ground and walk away. We need to build fences to protect saplings from wild animals and cut back invasive plants. However, there's a new strategy that's taking place in certain preservation communities, doing nothing. In 2016, world-renowned biologist E.O. Wilson proposed the Half Earth Project, where humans set aside half the planet's land and water as nature preserves. Research shows that it could prevent up to 80% of species extinction and allow for the world's forests to potentially regrow to pre-industrial age levels. It's a massive, wild idea, but Wilson wrote that humans long for big ideas like this to rally behind. The problem, of course, is that people live and work on these lands. Communities have to see a benefit in regrowing and maintaining lost forests. Not to mention that this is, again, developed Western nations asking the least developed communities to shoulder the weight of their past ecological damage. There's no universal answer to this problem. Every community will have different needs and different challenges. But getting to the half-earth goal means finding and supporting local communities who want to do this work, and more importantly, letting them take the lead.
Across the world, there are many, many communities who really value their natural ecosystems, and they will work very hard to not only bring those back, but to protect what they have. What we need to do is connect the dots and help resources to flow to allow these communities to engage in the activities that will really help them and their forests.
This is Robin Chasden. She's a tropical ecologist at the World Resources Institute, and she agrees that without community buy-in, there's no such thing as effective reforestation. We've pinned a lot of our hopes on reforestation, and it's an important strategy to combat climate change and recoup our biodiversity loss. But it also presents some massive challenges. We need to think about how to use native seeds to regrow forests. We need to think about how to shepherd and develop forests, not just replant them. We need to think about how we can disengage from the idea that all of the land on Earth belongs to humans. And we need to center and empower the voices of local communities. Before you go, we want to hear your feedback. Every year, PBS Digital Studios surveys our audience, helping us understand what you enjoy on YouTube. You also get to vote on new show ideas, so it'd be great if Far Out fans were well represented in the polls. Click the link in the description below.